Okay, I think this is quite complementary what I want to say, but it might seem awkward to deal with questions of fiscal compact, fiscal councils from a democratic citizenship perspective. So many might, not you, I'm sure the three of you are very concerned about questions of democratic legitimacy, the role of the parliament, of elected politicians, representatives. But to many in this debate, the question of democratic citizenship might seem awkward, and therefore I'm starting with a quote from H.L. Mencken, an American journalist, who said, "Democracy is the art of running the circus from the monkey cage." I'm arguing that we should look at the euro crisis and the responses to it exactly from this perspective, the citizens and citizens' practices who might seem comparable to that. Now, the puzzle of my research, and this is a first paper and cut through first results. The inspiration I take from Ralph Dahrendorf, who asked some 10 years ago, can European democracy survive globalization? I'm focusing on this question particularly in the euro crisis, in the context of the euro crisis, and specifically in Southern Europe. After the fall of the dictatorships in Portugal, Greece, and Spain in the 70s, Southern Europe was considered a laboratory and success story of democratic consolidation, economic growth, accession to the European Union, introduction of the euro, a golden decade of economics, development, social modernization, democratic consolidation, especially between 85 and 95, and after that a bit staggering. Now, in my paper, I submit that the future of democracy, of democratic consolidation, reconsolidation, and specifically of democratic citizenship is contingent on whether there are practices of a civilizational community emerging transnationally and capable of coping with what I call the dilemma of fiscal versus democratic deconsolidation. So talking about paradoxes, I'm talking here of a dilemma, dilemma of choice with which citizens are faced. On the one hand, either going with the growing disempowerment of nationally elected representatives, European representatives, versus non-elected, non-majoritarian agencies like fiscal councils, like ESM, the European Central Bank, and so on, European Commission, not to forget. The aim of my larger project is to, this is situated in a project exploring the political economy of democratic citizenship. I think that as comparative democratic theorists, analysts, we have somehow marginalized this political economic perspective. The fiscal, the material preconditions for exercising democratic rights in our quite affluent Western societies, and especially in Europe. On the one hand, given this paradox, or what I'm talking about, dilemma, regarding the interplay of, on the one hand, necessities of fiscal stabilization, which are portrayed as without alternative, on the one hand, and the requirements for democracy, meaningful democratic processes, on the other hand, there are two perspectives. On the one hand, there are those who warn that the politics of permanent austerity that EU leaders adopted in response to the financial and sovereign debt crisis puts democracy in straitjackets. Schäfer and Streeck have argued like this. The Council of Europe's Parliamentary Assembly has voiced fears also that austerity measures are a danger for democracy and social rights. On the other hand, however, there are numerous new ideas and conceptual proposals, strategies emerging from public discourses, reform discourses, regarding strategies for the role of the EU in the rescue of the Eurozone crisis, with the aim of strengthening not a supranational Leviathan centralization, but alternative to that, strengthening parliamentary and transnational democratic processes in EU governance, including deliberative processes and EU citizenship rights, but not only rights, but also certain obligations. No representation without taxation, fiscal obligations. And I am saying this particularly also taking into consideration the asymmetries between assisted states, assisting states in the present situation. Now, in my presentation, I'm the basic outline, and I'm sorry that I don't have a PowerPoint, but the basic structure is that I will look at the impacts of the austerity response to the financial, economic, fiscal and Eurozone crisis. I will look at this, at these impacts, structuring, let's say hypothetically, these impacts by three sets of hypotheses, followed by two major hypotheses regarding reform proposals. And this is for the time being what I can offer you here, since my empirical studies, which are in course, comparative quantitative studies on the basis of aggregate data, of performance of various dimensions, and survey data on the one hand, on the other hand, qualitative studies, conversations, interviews with experts, public intellectuals, activists with different kinds of situated knowledges in the capitals of, I have six countries, Germany, then there is Brussels, and in Southern Europe, Lisbon, Madrid, Rome, and Athens. Well, regarding the impacts of the austerity crisis on democratic citizenship, I should introduce a note what I understand here as democratic citizenship in the EU, since this is not at all in the interdisciplinary discourse self-understanding or self-explaining, self-explanatory. In legal constitutional in a legal constitutional perspective, EU citizenship is quite slim with an additional layer of some rights in addition to national citizenship rights, but at the status of national citizenship, but depending on the status of national citizenship. But here I'm adopting, as a Joe has proposed the framework of citizenship, European citizenship, as a space of rights, yeah, as a legal space, a contentious, a space of law, yeah? A space of law which is contentious, includes political processes, but I'm here adopting a deliberately political, social-political perspective, conceiving democratic citizenship in the EU as a community of practices, transnational. Not an international, this is a concept which Emanuel Adler has introduced and developed in international relations, international communities of practices. This is a concept, communities of practices, which citizenship education people are working with, yeah? Learning citizens, teaching citizens learning to develop practices of community, in terms of political, social, economic activities. So, and I'm adopting this concept here, democratic citizenship in the EU, as a transnational community of practices, or a civic community, it's also called. This is based on Joe Weiler, who in 1999, in an article, posed the question of European citizenship between passions and civilization. Yeah, it's a question of whether joining or adhering to national patriotic passions or endorsing civic principles, which are established and written into EU law and institutions in part, but also in international conventions and so on. So, well, this is the general concept, which I won't understand as a normative one, but as one which I think is useful for analytical purposes, for also structured and empirical research. And to flesh this a bit out, I'm of course relying and drawing on European democracy in Europe as it is enshrined and established by the Lisbon Treaty. And the Lisbon Treaty, in its chapter on the democratic life of the Union, introduces a multi-layered system of representation, including the national and the supranational level, introducing I'm not only looking, of course, at the provisions on EU citizenship in the narrow sense, but taking a broader look at the acquis on which EU citizenship in the political sphere can draw on. And in addition to the representative dimension, there is the participatory, civil society, the European Citizens Initiative. Then there are, of course, rights to claim rights for rights of non-discrimination, equal treatment in front of the European Court of Justice, through national courts, of course. And this means I'm also drawing on the acquis in terms of ECJ decisions in gender equality, gender non-discrimination, including and into the package of citizenship in the EU rights, on which practices can and do draw. Having said this, I want now to briefly mention that European citizenship in the EU, understood in this broader political sense of political practices, it presupposes and is evolving around two kinds of glues. Gluing citizens together, we have the euro on the one hand, the euro introduced in 2001 as the shared currency of 300 million citizens, which has of course also this symbolic identity constituting dimension, always had and attained. And on the other hand, these democratic principles, practices, which I consider also as a type of glue. Well, now turning to the context of the euro crisis, I suggest that there is a dilemma arising from what we have heard in the previous two papers, the fiscal compact, centralizing tendencies, delegation of power to non-elected agencies at the national and at the supranational level to an unprecedented degree. And therefore, I'm asking how to, first of all, better understand this dilemma for democratic citizenship in the EU, and on the other hand, whether in the current situation, the emerging practices, there are trends, tendencies that point towards overcoming this dilemma. And I have said that I have three hypotheses. I tend to speak 5 minutes, good, one for each minute and for each thesis. The first one is, I do it very quickly, that the austerity rule exacerbates tensions within and among national constitutional democratic citizenship models of delegation and accountability. That means I'm taking a political institutional perspective of what is the established model of democratic citizenship, means citizens' powers in delegating their power to representatives, forming governments, holding governments accountable, which is in the EU, has led to a multi-layered system of two tracks of national and supranational, yeah? Chains of delegation and accountability. And this is in trouble with respect to these new power concentrations. Second, from a structuralist comparative perspective, the austerity rule introduced by the European Council and adopted by member governments, specific member governments, also with some party political composition, which we shouldn't forget, they tend to rely on models, on assumptions regarding patterns of behavior of consumers, of investors, of political behavior. And what the examples and the testimony of Greece, Portugal show that these models, these assumptions have utterly failed regarding, for example, balancing the budget, cutting down excessive expenditure, how this would feed into recovery, economic recovery, capital investments. No, the opposite has been true. And what are the reasons? Why don't economic agents not behave the way that policymakers have assumed? This is a question of structural comparative analysis, where in particular I include also quality of governance at the national level, transparency of budgetary processes, how are budget processes organized, how corruption levels, which international NGOs have introduced in these debates without that they have been taken into consideration more seriously by the respective troikas, and so on. Then my third hypothesis looks at the tensions produced by the austerity rule. It's a level of discourses, contentious discourses, which take part in the mass media, in the streets, but also in particular among political and scholarly circles, communities, epistemic communities, neo-Keynesians opposed with neoliberals or orthodox or ordoliberal economists and policymakers. Well, these three kinds of hypotheses or sets of hypotheses open still very much to debate and to compare systematic comparative analysis. So far, I have collected more illustrative materials that support it. I will get to my final concluding two propositions which have surged from discourses about reforms, alternatives to austerity. And there is one which has been presented in the European Parliament by Miguel Poyares Maduro, discussed here in the European Parliament, strengthening the European parliamentary chain of delegation and accountability towards these unaccountable non-majoritarian agencies, but at the same time making votes also and elections count in the material sense by bolstering the EU or supporting it by a more substantive budget. And a budget that would not be fed out of the better doing member states, larger member states, alone and most significantly, but which would draw on the benefit created by the core of European market integration over the past decades, which is a single market which produces benefits which should and could be taxed in theory and which would be considered as socially just also to have these agents pay. Of course, there are political problems linked to that. And last but not least, a second dimension, in my view, it is not sufficient. It is necessary. It would be necessary, but not sufficient to bolster this chain of delegation accountability leading through the European Parliament, not at the expense of national parliaments, of course, but understood in a multi-layered system of interaction, cooperation between parliamentary agents, information sharing, knowledge sharing, and so on. But this is not sufficient in terms of educating, informing citizens, facilitating or inducing citizens, making citizens capable of acquiring and understanding sufficient enough to take part in elections, choose among alternative party platforms, strategies regarding how to counter the crisis which will be with us, and many guess at least for a decade or so. And I'm proposing here to draw on the deliberative turn in democratic political theory and on a toolkit of deliberative instruments, deliberative polls, citizens' consensus conferences, participatory budgeting, discursive representation. In summary, understanding this as an open process, I'm mapping the outcome in terms of two scenarios, one being the conducive to budgetary and fiscal consolidation, but at the detriment, at the cost of democratic quality, meaning democratic deconsolidation. And the second one would be one putting democratic consolidation first, but not forgetting about fiscal consolidation, aiming at balancing both components by testing the resonance, the viability, and the democratic legitimacy of these proposals for overcoming this dilemma. This is what I would like to discuss with you.
Thank you very much.